You know you're fortunate when you've traveled all over the world and there's still nowhere that inspires you as much as where you live. This is the Long Beach Island region of the famous New Jersey Shore. Only we don't call it the shore. We call it the beach. We call it home.
From the legendary Pine Barrens to blue offshore waters, local flavors to the Barnegat Bay, from our homes to our beaches, we explore our rich history as well as who's shaping our future. These are the stories of beach culture redefined. So we're taking you just beneath the surface. This is the Long Beach Island region as you've never seen it.
Farm work, wild animals, old trucks, and country roads. It's a different way of life. This is less than 100 miles from the heart of New York City. It's the New Jersey Pine Barrens, over a million acres of national reserve just inland of Long Beach Island. In the 1970s, New Jersey Governor Brendan Byrne pushed to stop development of this land. Today, it's a piece of nature that everyone in the state can be proud of. A backwoods of unique pitch pines, rare reptiles, carnivorous plants, bald eagles, and these folks, known as pineys. Let me tell you something. If you want to know about these forests and streams, harvesting cranberries or shellfish from the old ghost towns to the bay, ask a piney.
That's what makes you a true piney, when you can eat a raw cranberry.
The pines were originally mined for bog iron, but as the industry died out, the land remained relatively untouched. Families have lived here somewhat isolated for generations, mostly because they choose to. Even on LBI, we get our tap water from the Kirkwood Cohansey aquifers in the pines, some of the purest drinking water in the country. We still have no idea why vacationers bring cases of bottled water from the city. The pines are something of an escape, a place to duck away from the madness of the coast in the summer.
Agriculture is still a big part of life in the Pine Barrens.
Which is odd, considering the sandy, acidic soil actually kind of sucks for farming. But blueberries, and especially cranberries, tend to do very well here. People around the world drink juice with cranberries from right here. Farmers like Sam Moore at Moore's Meadows use the wet harvest method. It's not an easy life.
I'm sixth generation. This land was purchased in 1829. The ancestors used to just throw some dams up, you know, to divert water and that kind of stuff, and they picked them by hand out of the wild.
We've been here all our lives, and every summer was picking blueberries here on the farm. It was my grandfather's.
In 1954, this farm was ravaged by a huge wildfire, and they wound up kind of just letting them go and put more of their emphasis onto the blueberries.
She walked around with cherry earrings in her ear.
Then as history repeats itself, my father started to redo some of the cranberry bogs, the 1,000 acres we have here today.
He bought a cherry dress just to match, late June of last year.
Believe it or not, New Jersey is the most densely populated state in the country, but we're still 52% forest and open space. And the Pine Barrens is that million acres core area.
Being farmers and owning what land we own, it's, of course, we always have a lot of wildlife, deer, ducks, pickerel. We fish catfish a little through the summertime.
There's a lot of endangered species on our farmlands that we keep close protection of.
We like November. We're deer hunters. We just hunt the land we own. We don't bother going anywhere else.
You could leave here in a half hour, you're on Holgate surf fishing. New Jersey kind of has it all. You got the beauty of Long Beach Island that everybody enjoys, and then you have the Pine Barrens where you can do your hiking, you can watch the cranberry harvest, get your fresh blueberries. We're still able to work within the means of the Pine Barrens and enjoy it. I love where I live. We're our ocean spray growers, which is a cooperative owned by the growers. The fruit that you see out here now turns into the products that you get with the Ocean Spray logo on it across the country and world. You see it all the time. Of course, Craisins is the big kick. They have the trail mix. You have your juice, your sauce. They make cranberry wine. A lot of people get the misconception that cranberries grow in water. They don't. While they're dormant in the winter, we flood the bogs because that protects them from the outside air temperature. When April comes, we start letting the water off the bogs. They start to dry out and the growing season begins. As time goes on, they start to mature. We'll start to flood the bog as we're ready to pick it. The cranberries you see are very buoyant. They're held by a thread-like stem. We have a cranberry harvesting machine called a water reel harvester. It goes out and it actually bumps the berries off. Then we have the corralling boards. We still use the old cedar board, the old original. Then when they go from here, they go right into a truck. They go to Ocean Spray, then the truck comes back and we do the process all over again. This goes on for about the whole month of October. It's our season. 12 months a year, only one of it's where it counts. And this is where we have to make our money to survive the rest of the 11 months. It's called A Labor of Love. There was a good man by the name of Ed Lippman that wrote a book on the labor of love, and that dealt all with the cranberries, because there's so much devotion, there's so much stress. This is the happy times of the year. The wives see the other side of us at times when stress gets on, and you know, that's no ashamed in saying that.
I'm very proud of it. I'd like to pass it on from my grandfather, my father, to my son, and I hope there's enough money in it that my grandkids is able to do it.
I watch this farm evolve into what it is today, incredible. And I used to every day as a young man be right out here with my father doing it, running pieces of equipment, driving around, learning how to work the land and take care of it and manage it properly and be a good steward of the land. I learned all that from my father. I owe that to. He's the one that made me the person I am today.
No one has captured the magic of the Pine Barrens quite like Bob Birdsall. He's put in countless hours shooting not only the rare species that are unique to the area, but the people, the very folks who are living in another era.
The sun sets in the west over cedar trees so tall, and the waters black and still reflect a world that's best of all.
Like a lot of young guys growing up in South Jersey, joined the Cub Scouts. They'd go hiking in the woods and camping and sit around the fire, and the counselor scared to death about Jersey Devil stories. When I got out of the service, I moved down this way. I'm also a duck hunter. Got into photography. I put the hunting away for a while. The thing about wildlife photography, which is really great, is like if you go to Yellowstone or those great places, and I love them, you know, you drive along the roads and you'll see the bears. But here you got to work for it.
Here in the pine woods deep, where life is slow to change, I see beauty.
The Pine Barrens tree frog, it's no more than an inch and a half. It's an endangered species. They really tell you what's going on with the environment. But to photograph them, they're only out a short time of the year, which is usually late May into June, and you find them by going to a swampy area and listening to the mating call. And you gotta find them in the middle of the night. The first time that you find one sitting on a leaf, it's just a thrill. And then to photograph it, it's just incredible. And there's plants here, the curly grass fern. It's only this big. And to find those, you have to search, you have to talk with people, you talk with rangers, you talk with biologists.
There's berries on the bushes, along the streams and in the fields.
And we have 22 varieties of orchids to grow in the Jersey Pine Barrens. You have to get off the main roads, get on the sand roads. It just opens up the beauty of the Pine Barrens. So for a photographer, it's heaven. 10 years ago, I did a book trying to capture that way of life before it completely disappeared. At least it was a stake in time. At that moment, this is what it was, and we did capture quite a bit of it. If my photography does anything, it lets people know that it's really beautiful back here, and it really does need to be protected. The true pineys, the hunter-gatherers, that they work the cycle of the land, 12 months, they're doing pine cones, they're doing sorghum moss for the florists. There's only a few of them left, the way of life out here, that's disappearing, unfortunately. When I retired from AT&T, my wife and I bought one of those big old motor homes and traveled the country for 12 years, 6 months a year on the road, and we've probably been at just about every national park and photographed it in the country in Canada. But always come back to the Pine Barrens. We have places that you're only going to find here, just beautiful. Every day, the new adventure, it's back here in the Pine Barrens. This is still America. The people still have the values, they protect the land. It's been a great life here. I've been shooting for probably 45 years now, and it's been a wonderful experience.
Being on the water isn't just playtime around Long Beach Island. It's more like a way of life. We have 18 miles of ocean beaches to the east with acres of Barnegat Bay between LBI and the mainland. That's a lot of water to enjoy. Our boating traditions stretch back centuries, but there's something to be said for getting around on your own, from the dugout canoes and rowboats to rescue boards and modern kayaks. Prone paddling has always been a key life-saving skill and training regimen. About 10 years ago, the first stand-up paddleboard started showing up. Stand-up originated in Hawaii, where the Waikiki Beach Boys would use them to keep an eye on tourists learning to surf. It developed into a pastime more recently in Hawaii and spread from there, exploding on LBI the same way it did around the world. It's become a good business for retailers and outfitters. Now there's stand-up paddle fishing, eco-tours, cruises, races, and even yoga. Ken Gallant grew up surfing and then racing canoes. He wasn't the first to carry paddleboards on LBI, but in 2010, he and his wife Cheryl were the first to build an entire local business around it.
You know, smell that air. Is that not as fresh as it gets? I feel good breathing it.
Every day from the middle of June through September, he and his instructors get dozens of people on the water.
My parents moved here when I was born. I actually started surfing late. I didn't start till I was 12. But that was 50 years ago, so a lot of people in it, a lot of interest, and it's what got me going into this industry. I decided to feature stand-up paddleboarding. When on the East Coast, it was still somewhat in its infancy. The tours are a great success story. We have a guided tour. I have different instructors from different walks of life. Everyone looks good. Take a few strokes. All of a sudden, Ricky is headed for a dock. And so we say, sir, use the back paddle to slow that board down for a second. All right, we're gonna get you guys out now. Single file, come over the ladder. We take them out for roughly 2 hours. We show them how to do it. It's a great experience. So good that people come back every year and take the lesson again. Guys, to the left is the Little Egg Harbor sailboats. Those kids are probably all 6, 7, 8 years old. We point out turtles and birds. We sometimes stop and let them catch a clam or two. Of course, we put them back because they don't have a license. Hey, guys, I apologize for the small homes and the squalor ahead. Don't feel sorry for them. So you'd think some of the owners would not like us here, but I promise them bikinis 3 times a day, and they're pretty good. Many times people, when they first start, one of the first comments they make are, my legs are shaking, because you're nervous. As instructors, we call it the Jimmy leg. The funniest wipeouts are the real slow ones. 5 minutes from now, you get it mastered, and your legs stop. In the busy season, we will have 40 people a day, possibly, between our surf school, our stand-up paddleboard tours. Then the whole new thing is the racing aspect. The races we have here every year get bigger and more popular. Every shop on the island does some sort of race. We have 2 or 3. Island Surf and Sail has many. Farias and Surf Unlimited are behind all of it. There's a division for everybody, and people usually find that they do better than they thought. So then they get into it. Then they'll come to the next race more prepared, more physically fit, and some of our races will draw over 100 people. When paddling in the ocean, the dolphins seem to like us more so than a boat. And they'll swim with us sometimes for 20 minutes. And I've seen, like a TV screen coming into view, 150 rays coming up towards you and then back down. When you're standing, as opposed to a kayak, you can see more. We have seen whales. We've had fish land on the boards and fall back off. You're really becoming one with nature. My wife in particular comes back really happy after she's paddled. People are hands-on these days. They want to enjoy the ocean. They don't mind the instruction and the tutelage, and they come back the next time with their kids. And it really is fantastic.
These are our stories from the Long Beach Island region. It's really the characters who make it what it is. Stick with us, and we'll keep scratching just beneath the surface.
she's open your door.